paid, and we see the job through.
Whoever double-crosses me and leaves me alive, he understands nothing about good call.
You may run the risk.
I do the cutting.
I forgot to mention, he's not alone. There's five of them.
Five?
The good, the bad, and the ugly. Surely it is this movie that first comes to mind for each of us when talking about the Western genre. What is the secret of the phenomenal success of the film? What innovative techniques of visual storytelling did the director use? How did Sergio Leone's work inspire Quentin Tarantino? And how did Ennio Morricone's legendary soundtrack become the hallmark of the Western genre? The answers to these and many other questions are in today's video essay. And before we start, make sure to subscribe to our channel and watch our latest video where we conducted the most detailed analysis of the Godfather trilogy. You can also support our channel by following the link in the description. We will be grateful for any donation amount. Born on the 3rd of January 1929 in Rome, Sergio was the son of the cinema pioneer Vincenzo Leone and silent film actress Bicia Valerian. His father was considered one of the most important film directors in Italy, but in 1930, an angry and even offended Benito Mussolini, on pain of death, forbade him to make films because at one time, when Mussolini was not yet in charge of the country, but was a lower rank, Vincenzo Leone refused to film his novel, considering the plot banal. As soon as Mussolini sat on the fascist throne, he accused Vincenzo of communist propaganda, which left the director, who fell out of favor, with only one road: hunger and poverty. Despite the fact that the childhood of the future director was the most terrible and hopeless, after all, it was then, at the time of his youth, something happened that radically changed his life and determined his future. And it was not one, but two miracles. The first miracle is American culture. Like most Italian teenagers, Sergio doted on comics and westerns. The second miracle is cinema. The heart of young Leone was captivated by Her Majesty the Tenth Muse. The boy's parents, looking back at their fate, tried to dissuade or at least distract Sergio from his hobby. But all persuasions were in vain. The boy made a firm decision to follow in his father's footsteps and continue the family business. His parents resisted this, but in the end, it was his father who became the man who opened the world of cinema for Sergio. Step by step, Leone plunged into the boundless ocean of filmmaking. He, the future legendary director, spent as much as 10 years of his life learning how to make films on his own. 10 years. Even scary to imagine how a person can strive for the same goal for such a long time. But anyway, we all know and love Sergio Leone primarily as the founding father of the spaghetti western genre. If you want to watch a more detailed video essay about the entire Dollars trilogy or about Clint Eastwood, write about it in the comments. I would like to start with one of my favorite topics, namely, the introducing of the character by the director. Let's look at the first appearance of each of the main characters and see how this appearance characterizes them. The first in the film, Leone introduces Tuco. Let's watch this scene. We see the bandits enter the house, shots are heard, and then Tuco jumps out of the window. A signature freeze frame follows. Look at the moment when the director added. In front of us is Tuco's grin. He has a gun in his hands and a large meat bone. By the look of the character, we can understand that he was caught during a meal, and apparently he is upset by this, to put it mildly. Jumping out of the window, the character's facial expression and his appearance create the comicality of this moment. When Tuco leaves, the camera shows that he has took down all the thugs who wanted to kill him. We will return to this scene later, but the very fact that he killed three people alone, even when caught off guard, tells us about his quickness and perfect shooting skills. Such humor is great for introducing Tuco, because he is the most comical character in the film and he is responsible for most of the jokes in it. Then Angel Eyes appears in the plot. At the beginning, the character is shown from the point of view of a boy who runs away at the sight of a rider. From this, we can conclude that Angel Eyes is a harbinger of trouble. The character himself is on a black horse, wearing a black hat and dark clothes, which also does not inspire us with anything good. Here, I would like to draw attention to how the music emphasizes the appearance of the character, although we will talk about the music in the film separately. After a soothing melody, Ennio Morricone moves to an aggressive guitar part in the low register with a build-up effect. It is especially interesting that this build-up comes to an apogee exactly at the moment when Lee Van Cleef's character approaches the camera and comes to a close-up. Here, the build-up seems to pick up the movement of the actor who is moving towards the viewer, and at this moment the music also intensifies and seems to become closer to the viewer. This music and movement on camera with a close-up accentuate the character, and we understand that he plays an important role in the film. Then there is a very tense dialogue between Angel Eyes and a family man, a former Confederate soldier named Stevens. We have already seen this man's son and his wife before. Angel Eyes draws attention to the family photo and unequivocally threatens Stevens, who gives up the right name which Lee Van Cleef's character came to find out. What is interesting here is that Leone tries to personalize this family man as much as possible and shows a family photo, his wife and child. Moreover, in the photo, we see four people, including another son of Stevens. After the man pays Angel Eyes twice as much as he was given for his murder, Angel Eyes talks about his principles.
When I'm paid, I always see the job through.
And kills the man, thereby depriving the family of the breadwinner. Then Angel Eyes takes Stevens' money, which indicates that he doesn't have any moral values, and this is not counting the fact that he left two children orphaned, followed by an emotionally detached wide shot, where he kills the man's second son. At the same time, Angel Eyes shoots without a shadow of a doubt and doesn't even think about the fact that he is killing a child. Leone moves to a symmetrical wide shot from the back of the murderer. In the foreground is the corpse of the father of the family. In the background, Angel Eyes, as if nothing had happened, stepping over the corpse of an adolescent boy. The very fact that Lee Van Cleef's character is shown from the back depersonalizes him, and this perfectly emphasizes the dramaturgy of the moment. Then Sergio moves on to a point-of-view shot of Stephen's wife. She sees that her husband and son are killed, and this makes the scene even more emotional, and Angel Eyes is more ruthless. Van Cleef's character comes to his customer, whom he also kills, repeating his thought that he always finishes a job for which he is paid. Firstly, here the director reinforces the character's conviction, that is, creates his position as a person, which makes the character himself more understandable, and secondly, shows the ruthlessness of the character who kills his own customer. Hello, Anton Chigurh. By the way, it is interesting that first Angel Eyes puts a pillow on the man's face, and then shoots through it, thereby depersonalizing the victim and making the murder even more terrible. Then we hear malicious laughter and see the title The Bad with the creepy smile of Lee Van Cleef's character. By the title and by the look of the character, we understand that Angel Eyes is a clear antagonist in the story. Now it's time for Blondie. Tuco gets ambushed by bounty hunters. And let's see the first appearance of Blondie in the frame.
Hey, amigo, you know you've got a face beautiful enough to be worth $2,000?
Yeah. But you don't look like the one who collected.
First, we hear a voiceover. See how the characters, especially the one in the foreground, turn around when they hear Blondie's words. The voice of Eastwood's character is confident and calm, and he is not intimidated by the three opponents against him. The character himself appears in the foreground, which is very important, since the foreground with such a shot composition is what the viewer will certainly pay attention to. It is also interesting that Leone does not show Blondie's face for a long time. We see that he is calmly lighting a cigar, although the situation is very tense. Then the camera goes to a signature hip-level shot, where Blondie pulls his gun, and there is still no face of Eastwood's character, which provokes intrigue in the viewer. Masterful camera movement enhances suspense, showing the buildup of tension and the change of the dramatic block. Next comes the signature Western cut, the reactions of the characters in a close-up. Blondie deftly kills three bounty hunters, and we see a shot of his gun, still without the character's face. This scene makes it perfectly clear to us that Blondie is a great shooter. Eastwood's character approaches Tuco, and there is still no character's face. Leone keeps the intrigue as much as possible without revealing the character to us, but by doing so, he makes us understand how important he is. Then, in the shot over Tuco's shoulder, the character's face does not open immediately. The director clearly instructed Clint to hide his face behind a hat until a certain moment. And then Eastwood opens his face, and the iconic Blondie is in front of us. By the way, pay attention to his light duster coat, which contrasts with Angel Eyes' dark clothes. The appearance of Eastwood's character perfectly matches the entire Dollars trilogy in which his character is presented as a man with no name. And now, let's compare the amount of screen time that Leone gives to each of the characters. He devotes the least time to Tuco, since he is an ally of the main character, Blondie. Sergio gives Angel Eyes the most time, since the first scene with him we learn about Bill Carson, who hid the treasure around which the plot of the film is built. He also gives Blondie more time than Tuco, and thereby puts an emphasis on him. We can understand that this character is the protagonist. Interestingly, by the time all the characters are introduced in the plot, each of them killed three people. But at the same time, Angel Eyes' murders are shown more ruthlessly and treacherously, since he killed the father of the family and the child. This is one of the main features of the film and the spaghetti western genre as a whole. All three characters, from the point of view of morality and ethics, are far from the most pleasant characters. They are driven by only one desire, money. They are not deterred by the fact that they will have to kill for it. But Leone shows the antagonist more ruthless and terrifying, and against his background, Blondie and Tuco seem to be real angels who killed three people rather out of self-defense and inevitability, while Angel Eyes could not kill a man and thereby leave a child alive. It was in The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly that Tarantino sought inspiration for his typical script's structure from the point of view of the characters. In his films, Quentin also takes several bastards and makes some more cruel, which makes others seem more harmless. This theory is confirmed by the fact that The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly is Tarantino's favorite movie. Now let's talk about the visual aesthetics of the Western. The signature visual style of this genre is widescreen format, with an aspect ratio of 2.39 by 1 instead of the standard 1.78 by 1. The film was shot on 35mm film using Techniscope technology, which gave an aspect ratio of 2.33 by 1, and due to letterboxing, it obtained an aspect ratio of 2.33 by 1 for a theatrical release. Such an image in itself looks wider and thus creates a sense of deep space. Full-scale shooting in the desert gives a lot of freedom in choosing the way of framing, and Leone enjoys this freedom. It is an extreme wide shot that is one of the hallmarks of the Western genre. Such framing perfectly reveals the desert as an actor on the one hand, and on the other, demonstrates the devastation and difficult living conditions of people in this desert, and also often characterize the difficult situation in which the characters find themselves. In addition, for Leone, as for the Western genre as a whole, it is very typical to use wide shots along with close-ups. This compression of perspective from wide shots, shot with wider optics, to close-ups, shot with longer focus lenses, has a tremendous dramatic potential in terms of building tension and arranging visual accents. Also, Westerns are often characterized by shooting from the lower and upper points. A low-angle shot has long been a signature technique of the Western as a genre, where harsh, rude, and uncouth men kill each other down in duels. In Western films, the low-angle shot enhances the masculinity of the characters, as well as introduces additional tension into the frame. For the film, as well as for the genre itself, deep staging is also very characteristic. The widescreen format itself is simply created for this technique. Separately, I would like to dwell on this deep staging. Tuco is drinking water in the foreground. The very fact that Leone puts Tuco in the foreground speaks of his dominant position. At the same time, Tuco's umbrella divides the frame into two parts and even more clearly emphasizes the conflict. This separation limits Blondie's space. The very fact that Eastwood is in the background and therefore much smaller in size than Tuco speaks to his difficult position. It's also important to note the high angle shot, which also makes Blondie less significant against the background of the desert. And there is also a masterful work with light, since Clint is in the background lighting and is lost in the shadows, which visually suppresses the character. Leone also often uses triangular frame composition in the film. The triangle itself is the most visually aggressive geometric figure of the simple ones, and perfectly emphasizes the visual masculinity of the genre. Here, of course, it's worth highlighting one of my favorite movie shots from the final duel at the cemetery, where, in addition to the triangular composition, the characters are inscribed in a circle that highlights the triangle itself. It's important to note another distinctive feature of the film. Sergio often uses a zoom lens, but he does it very creatively. The director usually uses a whip zoom. Especially worth noting is the whip zoom on Blondie's gun at the beginning of the film and this gag with Tuco's boot. Leone uses a whip zoom to create a more dramatic or comical moment, thereby making an additional emphasis and deepening the dramaturgy. By the way, if you pay attention to Tarantino's films, you will notice the frequent use of this technique. Is it a coincidence? I don't think so. It's also worth noting the camera movement in the film. Here, Leone acts very carefully. From this point of view, The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly is a guide for working with tracking shots. Let's go back to the first scene of the movie. We see a wounded character who falls backwards. The camera follows him and reveals to us the corpses of two thugs who were killed by Tuco. Thus, Leone uses a closed frame, that is, a frame in which the movement of the camera reveals new information to the viewer. In this case, the camera movement looks motivated and justified and visually tells us a story. Well, now it's time to discuss the main scene of the film, the final duel, which has long gained fame as the best in the history of cinema. Here, the visual aesthetics of the spaghetti western is revealed in all its glory. Usually, when people follow only the plot of the film, they miss the most interesting. And now you will see how much information Leone laid at this moment with the help of visual storytelling. At this moment, we see a classic Mexican standoff when several characters simultaneously point the weapon at each other. The first frames meet us with an extreme wide shot. We see the characters in the cemetery where the duel takes place. This is a very important frame of this scene, as we see how the characters and their surroundings are arranged. All this will play a very important role in the future. Note that Angel Eyes is in the middle, and Blondie and Tuco are opposite each other, and this will be reflected in the following frames of the scene. The most basic information about the further course of the scene is given here. It should be noted that this scene lasts quite a long time. For 5 minutes, the characters stand opposite each other and only exchange glances. By the standards of modern dynamic cinema, it would be completely unacceptable. But this scene is a perfect example of how every second of screen time and every shot is calculated to create the necessary tension and set the rhythm of the duel. Not a second less, not a second more. Everything is clearly planned here. Leone gradually compresses the perspective more and more, moving from longer shots to close-ups, while increasing the pace of the scene. This raises tension and prepares for the final shot. And what about a duel shot? A loud bang and a thud of a falling body. Not particularly spectacular, right? In the duel scene, the main thing is not the gunshot itself, but what happens before it. The gunshot is only a catharsis of the general suspense, and only together they will be able to make the scene artistically significant. And here, suspense is built as well as possible. This is done by increasing the size of the shots, which helps to focus the viewer's attention and raise the bar of tension with each frame. Following the aforementioned extreme wide shot, which gives an idea of the placement of the characters and their surroundings, there is a wide shot from behind Angel Eyes, which gives us different information. This wide shot is taken as if Angel Eyes is standing much further away from Blondie and Tuco, who, on the contrary, are very close to each other, which seems precisely because of the chosen camera angle. But in fact, they all stand at an equal distance from each other. This determines the choice of the placement of the characters, which is made specifically for this shot. Because now we definitely see that Tuco and Blondie are working together. You may not understand it consciously, but on a subconscious level, it is imprinted. And then the director brings us even closer to the action, as there are three frames with a medium-long shot of each character. The medium-long shot, also known as American shot, is used to reflect the state of the character, which is expressed not only on the face, but also in the posture. See for yourself. Tuco is tense. Angel Eyes is at a loss, as if he suspects something, and Blondie cunningly and calmly assesses the situation. He has everything under control. This is followed by three deep focus shots over each character's shoulder. Note that all the shots go strictly in a circle. This is necessary so as not to confuse the visual storytelling. Using the deep focus over the shoulder shot, the director shows us what the characters see. Blondie is looking at Tuco. This emphasizes their partnership. Tuco himself is looking at Angel Eyes. This informs us about his aggressive attitude. And Angel Eyes is watching Blondie closely because he is the main danger for him. In total, this scene consists of 62 different shots, and each subsequent one is longer than the previous one. After this, we are shown close-ups of the holsters with pistols of all the characters in turn. This tells us that they are ready for battle, and there is no way back. Then there are three close-ups with all the characters, and this focuses the viewer's attention even more, as the duelists are shown to us closer and closer, which gives us the necessary information with each frame. Here we observe in more detail what we could have seen in the medium shot, but now on the face of the characters and not in the posture. Blondie is confident in the outcome of the duel and calm. Angel Eyes is perplexed and suspects something is wrong, and Tuco is confused. And finally, we are brought close to the faces of the characters. The close-up is taken. We only see the face of each of them. The degree of tension increases to the limit, and it is at this moment that the music starts playing as a prelude to the final gunshot. And here we come across a very specific type of camera angle, a hip-level shot, also called a cowboy shot, when the camera is placed around the waist height. The gun is in the foreground and the duel opponent is in the background. It is also important here that the camera angle from Tuco's gun goes to Angel Eyes and not to Blondie, although it would seem that they are standing opposite each other. Now we see that not only is Blondie not going to kill Tuco, but Tuco himself is determined to kill only Angel Eyes. In order for the viewer to finally understand this, there are four close-ups with only Tuco and Blondie's faces, where they look at each other, and Blondie nods to Tuco as a sign that everything is fine. That's what a close-up is for. Such an imperceptible movement as a slight nod can be easily tracked and thus get important information. Then the director moves on to extreme close-ups, where he shows the weapons and the eyes of the characters in turn. It's called the Italian shot. Their eyes are full of excitement, and their fingers are getting closer to the gun. The shots are changing faster and faster. Eyes and weapons, eyes and weapons. At the same time, it is once again emphasized that Blondie and Tuco are in an alliance with the help of the direction of their gaze. Blondie looks only at Tuco. Angel Eyes looks around, and Tuco is still at a loss. His gaze changes from anxious towards Blondie to aggressive towards Angel Eyes. And when the music reaches its climax and the change of shots occurs at an unimaginable speed, the gunshot diffuses the situation. See how natural, beautiful, and incredibly dramatic it looks in dynamics. Here, the director shows us that it is Angel Eyes who draws his gun first. In the next shot, we see Tuco reaching for his revolver. And then Leone elegantly completes the scene with a medium-long shot of Blondie, who pulls out his gun and shoots. As you can see, all 5 minutes of preparation for the final shot were clearly planned and verified to the smallest detail. Each shot is given as much time as it needs, and their sequence complements the semantic content of the scene. After all, knowing that Tuco and Blondie don't want to kill each other, the scene is perceived even more dramatically. It also adds a special romance to the final scene of the film, where Blondie shoots off the noose on Tuco's gallows and shares money with him. Also, pay attention to how the size of the shots increased along the course of the scene. First, there is an extreme wide shot with all the characters in the cemetery, then a wide shot with only the characters. After it, a medium-long shot, a close-up shot with the faces of the characters, which alternates with a close-up of pistols in a holster. Then there are extreme close-ups of their eyes and their hands reaching for the pistols. Leone enhances suspense of gradually increasing shots only by constantly accelerating speed of their change. In the finale, it becomes really unimaginable, and when the gun finally goes off, we are again returned to the very beginning. The extreme wide shot. The suspense is over. The scene is completed. Well, it would be a crime to ignore the music in the film. Of course, a great deal of the success of the movie is owed to its soundtrack, which has long received iconic status. The main feature of Ennio Morricone's soundtrack is its commitment to the musical leitmotif. This term refers to a musical composition that is associated with a certain character or dramatic situation. The leitmotif itself is based on the repetition of a musical theme throughout the film. This is its main strength. The viewer relates a musical composition to a certain character or dramatic situation, and when it is repeated, he has a feeling of déjà vu, which enhances the dramatic effect. Morricone's leitmotifs in this film can be divided into two types, portrait and situational. For each of the characters, the composer wrote his own musical theme. Let's look at each of them. The first is Tuco. Here we hear a funny sound of male vocals, stylized as the howling of a coyote, which makes us smile and reinforces the comical image of Tuco. Angel Eyes is characterized by a low ocarina sound. This bass perfectly characterizes the dark nature of the character. And the soft soprano flute is a sound portrait of Blondie. By giving each of them his own musical theme, Leone and Morricone create a strong association of a certain musical leitmotif with the character, and this is played out more than once in the film. Here's a great example. Tuco is going to hang Eastwood's character, but suddenly, a cannon shell hits the building. Tuco gets out of the wreckage, sees an empty noose, and at this moment, Blondie's theme is playing, which seems to emphasize that he managed to get away. And in this scene, Tuco's theme is used to emphasize the gag. Tuco thought that the soldiers riding towards him and Blondie were Confederates in gray uniforms, but one of the riders dusted off his sleeve, and it turned out that they were Northerners. Well, the three main themes of the characters, combining into a single track, give birth to the main theme of the good, the bad, and the ugly, which sounds in the opening credits. In this soundtrack, the drums perfectly imitates a gallop, which also adds authenticity. The paradoxical combination of instruments illustrates the forced and somewhat absurd cooperation of the main characters, and the use of one musical theme speaks of the commonality of their morals. Conceptuality is beyond praise. Now let's look at situational musical themes. Such leitmotifs characterize a certain dramatic situation. It is important to note that the earlier the leitmotif is presented in the film, the easier it will be for the viewer to perceive it in subsequent application. For example, the composer uses this leitmotif of an anxious bowed tremolo in tense scenes. A certain musical theme has also been written for scenes related to the Civil War. It sounds very tragic, expressing an attitude to war as senseless violence. By the way, this point of view was held by the director himself. And this leitmotif is used by Leone as a musical counterpoint in the scene of Tuco's torture by Angel Eyes. The music itself sounds very poetic and dreamy, which goes against the scene of Tuco's beating. Such a contrast emphasizes the ruthlessness and cruelty of Angel Eyes. It is worth saying that by filling the film with music, Leone and Morricone act very selectively. There is no endless soundtrack in every scene, which is very typical for many modern films. The director and composer don't litter the film with music, and this helps each score to sound accented. Adhering to the leitmotif themes throughout the film, at the end, Morricone departs from them and performs two separate musical themes that have become iconic: The Ecstasy of Gold and The Trio. The Ecstasy of Gold emphasizes Tuco's discovery of the cemetery where Bill Carson's treasure is hidden. Due to the fact that the viewer hears this melody for the first time, it sounds even more expressive against the background of other leitmotifs. The two final tracks are the most powerful scores in the film. If the previous soundtrack sounded more moderate, then here the full power of the string and brass orchestras falls on the viewer. The melody is increasing, and at the end it gains momentum, raises the tempo to match Tuco's running through the cemetery, and in the finale emphasizes the discovery of the grave. A three-way Mexican standoff is accompanied by the trio melody. It's very unusual to use crackling percussion, which sound like gunshots. This crackling comes right after the growing guitar part, which ends abruptly, and due to this pause, the percussion seems even more accentuated. The drumming in this scene is like a battle cry, which foreshadows the beginning of the battle. In this way, the composer enhances the suspense and adds additional tension to the scene. At the end, the tempo of the melody increases, and it stops right at the moment of the gunshot, thereby emphasizing it. I think this scene wouldn't have become so legendary without a soundtrack, since it is the music that creates the dynamics of the scene and, in fact, is the main action in it. This film is often included in the lists of the greatest movies of all time. The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly is a cinematic masterpiece that, for almost 3 hours of screen time, can keep any modern audience who has long been accustomed to half-hour drama series. In addition to Quentin Tarantino, the Coen brothers, Wes Anderson, the creators of the Breaking Bad series, and many other filmmakers were looking for inspiration in The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly completed Leone's Dollars trilogy and formed the phenomenon of the spaghetti western as a genre that had a significant impact on world cinema. The attributes of the genre, laconism, cruelty, anti-heroes as lead characters, black comedy, and realism, were replicated and exploited everywhere. For the excellent acting, picturesque landscapes, tense scenes, and for such a bold vision of an important historical period for ordinary Americans, The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly has become a cult film, proving that the frontier line runs not in the Wild West, but in every audience's heart. Yes, my friends, we have come to the end of the video. Don't forget to watch the top 10 Western movies and The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. Why is a legendary movie videos? If you liked the video, I would be very happy if you like and subscribe. Stay tuned. Goodbye.